Tēnā koutou, this module is the second of three on bias. It narrows the bias focus to ethnic bias, and particularly bias against Māori. It is a short overview on these issues. It touches on the role of Te Tiriti or Waitangi, as well as colonisation and racism, and their impact on Māori health. See the Health Quality and Safety Commission website for further information and learning. Racism is a system of beliefs and practices that society has, and these beliefs and practices can be seen in systems, institutions, and individuals. Societal racism leads to bias against some ethnicities. In July 2019, the Health Quality and Safety Commission released its latest window on the quality of Aotearoa New Zealand's healthcare. The report focused specifically on Māori health equity. The report shows a pattern of inequities between Māori and non-Māori over their lifetimes. Health services are less accessible for Māori. Health services are not providing the same benefits for Māori as for non-Māori. Efforts to improve the quality of health services do not always improve equity for Māori. The report says that colonisation, failure to meet the requirements of Te Tiriti or Waitangi, and institutional racism have established a maintained advantage for most non-Māori and disadvantaged Māori at the same time.
Kia ora, my name is Anthony Stevens, and this is Tonia. It's my eldest son. He has Down syndrome. Tonia, he's quite an active boy. Being a young teenage boy, he loves basketball, loves his rugby. What else do you love, Tons? Music?
Yeah.
What sort of music do you like?
Mine.
He loves his hip hop and his rap. What else do you like, Tons?
Yeah.
Kapa haka?
Yeah.
In my experience with accessing healthcare for Tonia, on initial consultations, whether it be orthopaedic, ENT services, or any other health service, often we find, especially with administration staff, that they make the assumption that often our whānau don't understand our son's condition. With comments like, do you understand your son has Down syndrome? Do you understand what that entails with that condition? And often that comes across as patronising for us. It's often the assumption made that we're either poor, being Māori, socially deprived. There's an undercurrent of racism there. Often it's a body language, you can often tell. And just little remarks. More often than not, the experience has been very, very cold, sterile. In an ideal world, I'd just like to be treated in an open, honest way, treated fairly, and regardless of my colour, race or creed. Don't make assumptions in regards to what we know about our son's condition. Just be honest and genuine, really, with their engagement, rather than seeing us as as another patient on the seat. Even just to open up with some pleasantries first, perhaps, and just and rather than just seeing the condition that they're dealing with, is to how's his day been? How's he been at school? Just simple things like that. Yeah, taking the time to get to know Tonia, aside from just his disability.
How did it?
Good boy.
There's certainly a difference in the way that Māori and Pākehā patients are treated at general practice and at hospital level. I think it needs to be said that it's not likely that doctors know that they're doing this. And it's not that they do it on purpose, but very clearly in general practice, we spend less time with Māori patients, we make a diagnosis less frequently, we give fewer prescriptions, we give fewer referrals to hospital, and when we go to hospital, We have fewer interventions. We have worse death rates for Māori patients. And Māori patients tend to spend longer in hospital. I think some of the impacts upon Māori patients are that they, is that we don't feel heard. We feel as a patient, as a Māori, that this person is not thinking about me, that this person is thinking about somebody else in somebody else's situation. The difference between cultural competence and cultural safety is that with competence, we often end up othering the other person. We go out and we learn about somebody else's culture, somebody else's way of doing things, so that theoretically we can better understand why they do what they do and treat accordingly. In fact, it appears that we've been doing this, we've been certainly trying to do it in the medical profession for 30 years, and it hasn't made a stitch of difference. What we're now trying to do is to move us from cultural competence to cultural safety. And cultural safety is a concept whereby we tend to think more about the power relationships between the professional and the client or the patient. We like to think about having the professional person thinking about their own culture, their own biases, the way they think about the interaction, and how their biases affect the outcomes for the patient.
Nō te taitokere ahau, ko ngā pohi te iwi, ko mā hurihuri, rātou ko Ngāti Hene, ko Ngāti Rangu Oku Hapu. Engari, e noho ana au ki Tamaki ki Tonga, in ānei. I am a general practitioner at Papakura Marae Health Clinic. I'm also associate professor in general practice at the University of Auckland Medical School, and I sit on Waitamata District Health Board as the appointed member for Māori Health. So the process of colonisation, particularly in terms of Māori health, has been both insidious and I think explicit. The whole system was set up to disadvantage Māori and advantage non-Māori, particularly Pākehā people. It meant our whole health system, particularly hospitals, have been taken from models set up in the UK, where the rooms are very small and are all about the individual, not about whānau or that collective responsibility. And then more explicitly within the hospital and within our primary care system too, we're seeing unequal treatment for Māori, so that they're missing out on evidence-based gold standard treatments, and as a result are becoming really unwell and for some people dying as a result. Institutionalised racism is, I guess, undermining the mana of Te Tiriti of Waitangi in terms of not allowing Māori leadership, whether that's of funding and decision-making and contracting. I think that's a major issue. I think it undermines the whānau voice and how services are determined and implemented. I think it means, a lot of our district health boards have one or two Māori members on each of them. If we were wanting a true Crown Treaty partnership, we'd be looking at having significantly more numbers given the inequities that we have at the moment. So it's kind of making sure that the rules and the processes and policies are have Māori leadership and behind them and have an equity lens so that we know that they're going to be achieving equitable outcomes. I think there are a number of simple things that we can do as clinicians to improve the way that we are engaging with Māori in meaningful ways so that we're improving their well-being. Reflecting on our bias. So the implicit bias tests are easily available to all people now. You can do them online. It's worthwhile doing that and just actually seeing for yourself whether or not there is some bias in the way that you engage with people. I have a colleague, Dr. Tia Carlson, who's just done her PhD looking at health literacy for heart disease in older Māori. And she ended her talk with this beautiful saying. She said, you know, as as clinicians, just, she said, whakarongo, whakarongo, whakarongo. And she said, you think that means listen, listen, listen. But what I'm saying is listen with your mind. Be mindful of how you are at that present time with your patient. Is there baggage that you might be holding? Is it the end of the day? You know, be mindful of why you might not be in the best place at that time to engage. Whakarongo with your heart. So be loving to people. Always think that they've come to you because they think that this is a time to be valued in their lives. So value that person in front of you. Show aroha. And whakarongo with your gut, I guess, is trust that gut instinct and that there might be things that they're not able to tell you. And in that situation, you might want to get another expert in, whether that's kaumātua support, community health workers, or another Māori clinician to support you and them in their health journey.
The inequity data is there for everyone to see. And it affects Māori throughout their whole life course, from before they're born to when we die, younger than our non-Māori counterparts.
Strategies that organisations can implement to address implicit and unconscious bias include providing data about different approaches and outcomes for some groups. For example, prescribing data, which shows that Māori are prescribed fewer drugs than other groups. Having a commitment to a racism-free environment supported by leadership policies and practices. Actively upholding the Treaty of Waitangi through employment practices, policies, and engagement with iwi and Māori communities. Support staff to learn about te reo and cultural safety. And as an organisation, advocate against racism.
The 2019 amendment to the Health Practitioners Competence Assurance Act 2003 requires health practitioners to respond effectively and respectfully to Māori.
Now you have watched this module, we invite you to make this just the start of your learnings about bias in healthcare. To find out more, make sure you watch the other two modules in this series of three and see the Health Quality and Safety Commission's website. Kia ora tātou.